Good evening once again, my friends, and I welcome all of you to... Once again, we discuss the sort of the issues about the representation of the unemployed and the poor and those who are in general the most vulnerable members of our society, and exactly sort of television's very strange approach to their level of representation. Because one might argue that there's been a certain lack of representation from just about every walk of life, from every part of society, that just because what you see on a television screen, the limit is by its aspect ratio, the shape of the program. So by the time you turn the television off and you go out into the real world, you're going to be seeing a much larger picture, metaphorically and perhaps even literally as well. And I bring all this up because in our previous video, there was a very certain level of respect that the program did have in naming some things or the way it showcased certain things about the people we talked about, mostly because the previous episode we talked about was 100 stone and on benefits. And again, aside from some things that, to be honest, I really had to sort of like raise my eyebrow at, it was overall a very a dignified and respectful display, all things considered. However, as I'm sure we all know, inequality is as strife as many of the people who collect their winnings, as far as we know, because there are always people out there who have a very Darwinian, let's call it that, we'll call it a very Darwinian approach to the class problem or weight problems. And what you're going to be showing, what we might be seeing here otherwise, ladies and gentlemen, is probably more problems of when you do this. And again, I don't work in television, but I know a lot about how the television world works. And what you're going to be seeing here is just, it shouldn't be the standard, it's just sort of what happens. So, and apparently it's meant to be called supersized, so let's just get straight to it. I'll try not to talk too much in this one, but if it's things I will only pause if things I really have to address. I think that's the way we should do it.
Britain is bulging with people who are now too fat to work.
I think already that's like not even 10 seconds, but let's just 5 seconds, I should say. Let's do it.
Britain is bulging with people who are now too fat to work.
Let's just, again, go through it step by step. Britain is now bulging. They obviously tried to use a metaphor or a simile to simulate about people's weight gain. That's already, they try to almost like glamorize it, say that, you know, look at us, look at how clever we are. We use the words, which obviously means to expand in size, and it's a program about fat people. So they must think they're really, really clever for saying that. And again, you know, they say too fat to work. Again, I just want to say, you know what, with the benefit of hindsight, since the pandemic and, you know, the rise of people working from home, there really is like no excuses to certain things, but I'm sure we're going to get into other points aside. But at the same time, I have always like had the belief, and I did this when I did the political compass test, is that if there's work you can do, no matter your circumstances, then there are ways out there. You know what? Again, when... This just, did Stephen Hawking stop trying despite what happened to him? No, of course it didn't. And then again, maybe some of us are just not, you know, not bored with that, you know, it's a very divisive issue because many of us are not, we are not Stephen Hawking. And there's also let's just keep going.
I find it very hard to do certain things because of my weight.
They cost the taxpayer £10 million each year.
And again, this is something I brought up last time, is that can we see some facts? Can we see some evidence? Are you trying to say that, so for the last 5 years, we've paid out £50 million because people are unable to work because of their weight? One, it's got a lot more to do, more than just people who are overweight is why they can't find work, and those who are unemployed. Also, that statistic is, it's wildly inaccurate.
We get about £1,500 a month.
And we're paying out for their benefits.
I worked all my life,
again,
so why...
And you see again the huge, huge elephant in the room is when... For reasons that... let's just do it again.
£1,500 a month.
And we're paying out for their benefits.
We are paying out for their benefits. Who is we're? Is that me? Is that people like, you know, the woman presenting? Is that she... They run this sort of narrative where we should feel disgusted by them because so they try to assimilate the idea that the only reason why they are that this way is so that they can claim benefits and they don't have to work, that the state will just look after them. And by and large, the taxpayer is going to look after them. And you're just right there, you sort of run into a lot of the problems I do have with these sorts of narratives. They try to... It's not about, you know, showcasing, you know, that exploiting their misery. It's about making us feel like that we should be lynching them. And there's more because of stuff like this.
I worked all my life, so why can't I have a little bit back?
For their medical treatment...
Obesity is costing billions, the NHS.
I take about 17 tablets a day.
And for the cost of adapting their homes.
My occupational therapist had the council...
And of course, adapting their homes. And she says that with shock, as though, can you believe it, my dear? But, you know, what, only last time we're having to have someone to weed the garden, we couldn't. They were so overweight that they couldn't bend forwards. That's all that's wrong with them. Ladies and gentlemen, I say this right now. When you do programs of this nature, you have it. It's probably maybe fortunate we probably don't see her face in all this, because she talks down to people who are overweight and whether they are in work or out of work. If you know what, if we were discussing literally about working people who were slightly overweight, and they had to have certain things about, you know, their lifestyle, their sanitary arrangements, and that had to be adjusted, she would immediately be going, yuck, have you seen that? And they, you know what I mean? But is it just because it's a weight thing, or is it because they're unemployed? That's what, again, if this was about people who were in work and who were overweight, I think it would it be the same, or do you think her tone would have changed? That's a very difficult thing to say because I honestly couldn't tell you.
Wet room for me.
We're even forking out for cleaners.
Mop. And if you can hoover in there and in here.
Carers.
Is there nothing else there?
A salad cream, perhaps.
And brand new kitchens.
The plastering is absolutely abysmal.
Meet the people who can't work.
I just got to sit here and everyone moves around me.
Don't work.
I've paid into my system. I'm entitled to get the stuff that we get.
Or whose size stops them getting work.
It comes down to discrimination of your size.
Okay, so we went from can't, don't, and stop. Can't work, don't work, stop working. It's probably for the best that she didn't also mention they don't want to work. Because then you make this almost look like class warfare. And again, because of what I know, I think, to be honest, when you do programs like this, you run a very, very thin line in the first place. Back to what I was talking about with Jeremy Paxman and Jerry Springer. But in this, you run a very, very fine line. If it's just to shove the cameras in their face and explore their lives, it's a very authoritarian sort of approach right now, especially because, well, like I said before, what do the people get out of it for appearing on these shows? Go out of, you know, the page book of what Jerry Springer said, but just what, again, it's because, you know, TV programs aren't cheap, and okay.
They say they're not super-sized scroungers and entitled to every penny.
Okay, so there you are right there. She's an orphanarian right there. Just listen to that and quote, and I'm just quote her.
They say they're not super-sized scroungers and entitled to every penny.
Where's her evidence? Can she prove that any of them said that? Because, one, no human being in Britain is ever going to admit that they're a scrounger. Second, just to say that, you know, they are not super-sized, it doesn't one, define super-sized. Second, I don't really think they're going to deny that they, you know, they're not exactly what you call like comparison to a spring onion either. You make people like them look like they're in complete denial with all touch of reality. No, actually, I think the woman who's voicing this is completely out of touch with reality. I really do.
Don't judge me unless you've walked a mile in my shoes.
The sooner I get back working, the better.
You can't turn around and say to somebody, oh, because you're obese, it's your fault.
And again, 87 stone, fat chance of work. Again, who came up with that title? Did they think this is funny? No, it's not funny. When she says, you know, again, I'll just point this out.
Oh, you can't turn around and say to somebody, oh, because you're obese, it's your fault.
Okay, first a few things. One, if you're shoveling nearly 4,000 calories into your body a day and you don't exercise, and about 10 or so months later, you gain nearly 7 stone, who's to say, you know what, that's the case? And also, again, I think the reason why some people wouldn't turn around and say that directly to somebody's face is that there is a certain level of decorum that many people in Britain do have. Well, mostly those who do have an element of shame in them and know that just saying something like that is going to be detrimental and hurtful to a person's feelings. And I know people who are morbidly obese, people I've worked with who are morbidly obese. You know what? Do I ever make mention of it? No. No, of course I don't. Because, A, that's discrimination of that sort is a sackable offence. Second, just why? What good does that do? It doesn't do really any good to anybody. I think, again, one thing I'll just... We've been doing this for nearly 15 minutes. We're not even past the intro yet. I'll just keep it simple. If people could see inside themselves, like via an x-ray or something like that, to see exactly what's going on inside their bodies, that would change people's opinions right there. And that's the same same slice of life I took when I was about 19, and that's just sort of how it is. And by the way, this shirt's just quite big, and so, and I've lost quite a bit of weight since 2 years ago. And daily dose of internet, it's cool. I like it. Anyway, here we go.
Stone Debbie Wood is morbidly obese and hasn't worked in 4 years.
Can I just, again, the first thing that comes out of her mouth when the actual program begins is her size. Are you kidding me?
21-stone Debbie Wood is morbidly obese and hasn't worked in 4 years.
Also, again, I don't exactly know who needs to tell the woman this, Debbie Wood or... No, that's Debbie Wood as well. But... yeah, when you get to 21 stone, yes, of course you're morbidly obese. I mean, who's going to deny that? This is another thing as well, shows like this fall into the trap of, is that they're not very respectful to their audience either.
She lives in a two-bedroomed council house and along with her husband gets £1,500 a month in benefits.
I've paid into my system. I'm entitled to get my disability, my carers allowance, my income support, and all the rest of the stuff that we get.
But Debbie hasn't always been this big.
I've never had this much weight on me, so I find it very annoying. I'm actually carrying 10 stone more than what my normal body weight should be. I find it very hard to do certain things because of my weight.
One of the things 21 stone Debbie finds hard is household chores. Luckily though, the council have provided her a cleaner who comes round 3 times a week.
If you can clean the kitchen, wipe down the tops, do the bathroom, obviously the toilet area underneath the lid and everything, and oh, if you can do the front of the toilet as well, round the base of it, mop, and if you can hoover in there and in here.
And maintaining Debbie's extremely high standards isn't easy.
Now you know why we like her so much.
As well as Debbie's cleaner, her husband Steve has found his calling as her full-time carer.
Steve does get an allowance for caring for me. It's not a great deal, but it is enough to help her out a little bit.
Well, me and Debbie met through a mutual friend on Facebook. Her friend, well, she basically posted Debbie's number saying, for a good time, call this number. And from that one little comment, it led to this.
Take that out, take all that out, take the shelf out and wash it properly. I just said take it out and put it on the shelf.
To me, marriage and caring, they go hand in hand anyway. That's what marriage is about.
Take out the actual shelf itself and wash it in the sink.
You know, I appreciate Steve. I mean, Steve sounds like an absolute trooper, to be honest. But no, it's... No, to be honest, again, the fundamentals about, like, marriage is... Listen, I'll just keep this short because, you know, I would not marry somebody who had to be 100% dependent upon me. And you know what, because that's just, that's not love. And because, yeah, you know what, I know what love is, ladies and gentlemen? Well, it's among many other things, but you know what it is? It's being a little bit appreciative, being a little bit thankful. And again, I'm not trying to, you know, defend the show or anything like that and what it set out to do, because you can clearly tell what it set out to do. And even getting out of the realm that, you know, it is true that some people, it is absolutely their own fault and their attitude leads to a lot of these sort of problems. But again, with the way this show is like formulated and the way it's edited and the way it's, you know, gone through editing again and then sent to producers and then sent through executives and then sent to the standards agencies and then has to go through things like, again, like probably more government approving and something like that if it's dealing with issues related to the related to people who are unemployed. And then it has to be scheduled and then it has to be edited again so it beats, you know, an hour in length. Because they must have filmed like nearly like 13 or so hours in this and they had to like really condense like a lot of things down because of programs of this sort. And then they have to schedule it, and then it has to be commissioned. Well, it's probably already been commissioned, and then you have to find a slot, and then you have to broadcast it. So there's so much that goes into it. So they must have known exactly. They must have looked at moments like this, saying, "Yes, we can put that in. That will shape people's opinions."
Get on a damn sight better that way.
Being Debbie's carer is such a 24/7 job. The job centre do sort of leave us to it, and I've only ever had like 2 appointments in the last 2 years I've had to go to, so.
Watch the eggs. Why are you putting them there? You know the door's going to swing back, and I'm going to stand here and hold the door because I'm in pain. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to hold the door. I know what I'm doing.
Although husband Steve is university educated and is fit enough to work, the state have paid him to be her full-time carer for the past year.
I'm always having to think
so
a few
again,
steps.
If it's not so it's Steve's fault now, is it, that he's resorted to being a full-time carer? But what about those who also go into full-time caring and that? Is it their fault as well that they're supporting a woman's lackadaisical lifestyle? It's always somebody else's fault with this woman. That's what I've come to the realisation.
steps ahead, what might she want?
Mind you, that being said, probably this isn't the actual thoughts of the narrator. Maybe this is just what somebody has paid her to say. I hope that's the case. Well, I, you know, yeah.
Where's my glasses?
They are.
I knew straight away it was going to be vile.
Also relying on the state to support him is 35 stone Les Price, whose council house...
Was it really necessary to film him, you know, with his with most of his clothes off? What's the point in this?
...has been specially modified to accommodate his size. Council house has been specially modified to accommodate...
Yeah. That's the face of somebody who obviously does not want to be drinking out of a mug with Mr. Greedy on it. They 100% put this man up to this. I hate this. I absolutely hate this. Because you know exactly this was not... This was intentional. They... You know, it's a bloody good job I applied for an MA in screenwriting, because how much... Again, it does take a lot of effort into, you know, making programs of this, but that's like... That's like scraping the barrel, that is. This... Everything. Everything about this is scraping.
It's his size.
Excuse the mess, and welcome to the boudoir. I've had some creams off the doctor because I got open sores, but I use like body butters for my belly because I have got like scabbed areas where things to rub. Ooh. I did make the mistake once of getting my capsicum cream mixed up with my antibiotic cream. And trust me, when you get that in the wrong place, you know about it, because capsicum is a pepper and it doesn't go well on your groin. And I did scream and I was crying and my missus laughed at me because I was crying for my dad. You are what you are. You know, if you're meant to be fat, you'll be fat. If you're not, you're not. I don't want to be this size. I've never want.
Again, did somebody ask pay him to say that? This is, again, what all this has done now for me is question the judgment of literally everything they are saying now. Because parts of me are literally now starting to consider the idea that, you know what I mean? When you start... No, you know what? Guys, I've told you this before. I used to be enormous. I used to be, like, knocking on very nearly 18 stone. You know what I weigh now? Less than 15 stone in the span of about 8 months. It wasn't hard. It wasn't easy. It meant through, like, a lot of very, very painful days at work and a lot of... There were days I literally wanted to, like, burst into tears, to be honest. But I'm getting through it. Because, you know what? Because I chose to lead a healthier lifestyle by recognising the fact that I had a problem and that I had to sort myself out. Some people are just born to be fat. No. It's not something that's predetermined before you're even born. That's not how that works, pal. I'm sorry.
Wanted to be this size.
Although Les has always been overweight, it was an accident at work.
Always been overweight. So the fucking moment he was born. Oh my god. This fucking... Oh god. You're probably going to get sick of me having to pause this at every moment that... makes me want to makes my jaw want to hit the floor, but it has to be said. Who, where, what
caused him to balloon in size, and he's not had a job since.
My last job, also, I had a back accident.
Also, again, they used the word balloon there. Why would you use the word balloon if has caused Les to gain weight over the years? You've got to be respectful. You know what? You've got to be respectful to these people. You know what? This isn't... They are not defenseless animals and that, who are completely, you know, abhorrent from criticism or that. But the problem is that, you know the saying, you know, criticism is not harassment. Part of me is now beginning to feel this is like harassment, because this almost opens the floodgates to anybody to say anything they want to people like Les and Debbie. And again, whether or not Debbie is a good person or not is out of the question, because you've got to be a good person towards her. And, you know, this is just more calling about what I know about how I was brought up and how I used to treat people. But it might be the case that just Debbie... Well, what about Debbie's respect for her husband? But again, like I said before, that could just be from what they're showing on screen.
Carrying a slab of concrete and twisted and popped my back and left me immobile for months. Life is hard since. Don't judge me unless you've walked a mile in my shoes.
Handsome devil.
Les can't walk a mile in his own shoes because just hauling his 35-stone body around at home can be a struggle.
I've been immobile now for a few years. I get disability living allowance and I get mobility. I could have a mobility car. I can't get out and exercise. I used to swim, but I got told not to swim because I got problems with my shoulders. And once I've swum, I can't physically dry myself and change. I need help.
To make life easier for Les, the council fitted a wet room to accommodate his enormous dimensions.
A shower that you can sit down, which is a godsend, because if I had a stand, I'd be in agony. My partner helps me shower because I can't do it all on my own. It's the purchase store for when I have a shave and everything. Yeah, struggling a minute.
Standing for long periods is a huge challenge for Les, who gets £300 a month in disability living allowance.
It is hard because I get breathless and my back aches.
You know, part of me also wants to imagine, and maybe this is a bit more about things about how, like, government spending works or the machinery about how, like, the DWP, for example, operates. But some might argue, would it not just be better if people came forward saying that they hate the way that, you know, if they hate their size, they want to lose weight, but for medical reasons it would become extraordinarily difficult, and why could they just not have, like, weight loss surgery that way? I mean, if they're more than open to work, then that's all work in the sort of jobs they still want to be able to do. Or that's just sort of... Would it not be better to do stuff like that than to just throw around, like, £300 or £400 or £500 in disability allowance? Or, again, should it not be reserved for more serious cases? Or, this is only really a rough idea and there's some very serious objections to my suggestions. Nevertheless, it does represent a question. I mean... It's because it's an absolute disgrace that people who are more than capable of working, who suffer through injury, and all of a sudden it makes life seem very, very difficult to contemplate. It's the sort of thing that I couldn't even imagine I would be in myself. And if I had a problem, ladies and gentlemen, like that, I would want to have it seen to immediately. Because how can you... Again, because I'm not Les's size, like I says, I've never walked in his shoes, but I couldn't see myself living like that. And that's not being disrespectful to Les, but this is just it's what I think anyway. That's the best I could say.
I get cramp in the back of my legs, my hips. I can't rely on everybody for everything all the time, so I do try to do my best, but. It's not always easy.
Les isn't the only one whose size holds him back. Debbie Wood hasn't left her council house for 8 months because she worries what people will say about her size.
It's the same for most people who are overweight, and it's a sad state of affairs that we can't go out and get the exercise that we need for fear of other people making fun of us.
The council have specially modified Debbie's...
Well, you know what, Debbie, there would have been a point in my life where I probably might have said the same, but if people have got something they want to tell you, then they should just go and say it to you, to yourself, and they or they should have said it to my face. And you know what, if they do not... if again, it wouldn't it not show a little bit more admiration for the fact that, you know, people who try? You know what I mean? How many times have I said, ladies and gentlemen, you know what, it never stopped me from trying. The situation I might be in might not be great, but again, it never stopped me from trying. And what I think the biggest problem with so many people like Debbie, and there's probably thousands of people just like her who are so self-conscious and worry about self-image, at least I think that's what the case here, is that maybe they've just never been told, or they've never had anybody to actually tell them, you know what, it's absolutely possible for life to get better. It's absolutely possible to turn things around. These people, and there's so many thousands like them, they say it's like living is like staring doom in the face. But life is not about staring doom in the face. There's so much more to it than that.
Home to accommodate her needs.
My occupational therapist had the council put in a wet room for me. I've had this specially adapted because I can't stand for too long. This is actually the longest I've stood for a while. To go like that really puts pressure on my knee. Oh, and I can feel it right here. People just think, oh, she's standing, she's walking around, there's nothing wrong with her, you know what I mean? But they don't have my aches and pains and they aren't me, so they can't judge.
Debbie's pride and joy is her £800
muscle. Unfortunately, Debbie, they still do. I mean, just because you say they can't doesn't mean they won't. You know what I mean?
...large bed, which she bought online with her benefits money.
So special about the bed is the fact that it's adjustable. So it lowers, and this bit here comes up. It's like when my ankles are hurting, it comes up like that. Ah, yeah. It gets a massage.
And the amount of beds that we've had to, different beds we've had to try out just to get comfortable.
And we had a king size, we had a double, we had, orthopaedic mattresses. And then you can show that your side it has remote as well.
Oh, yeah.
You might be younger than me, but he still has his aches and pains as well, the same as anybody else. So, I mean, I've got to keep him in good health and... so he can take care of me, you know.
Coming up, Debbie treats herself to a treadmill.
Woohoo, look at me go.
And we meet a giant job seeker who claims he can't get to work due to his size.
And they literally just called him a giant. Again, not to put finer point upon this, but why? I wonder exactly how many of these shows actually still go on, like, whether it's on Channel 5 or anything like that, because, to be honest, I think somebody must have looked at this and they must have said to themselves, this isn't...
discrimination of your size, you know?
21 stone Debbie Wood and her husband receive $1,500 a month in benefits.
I do get organic stuff, so I do pay out.
Also,
a bit,
how dare this show uses a rendered version of "Wouldn't It Be Nice" by the Beach Boys? Don't patronise us further by using that song. It's bad enough Sky started using that song, but don't, please don't.
Extra. What maybe some would.
As well as splashing out on organic food, Debbie spends £71 a month on socks, her pet cat.
I've got to buy him his food and his litter, and he gets his treats as well.
Debbie insists she's frugal with her money.
If I do have anything extra, sometimes I will, you know, put it towards getting something nice, like a new TV or something.
Her latest treat is a treadmill, which she bought online for £149.
Start. And it tells me how many calories I've burnt. I burnt 0.5 calories already. Woohoo! Look at me go. That's 6 calories. 7, 8. I do about 10 minutes every second day or every day. That's 3.8, 3.9. 5.
You know
0.
What, again, I'll just say this, I'll say this to her, Debbie. You know what? If you're not working, and if you really were that committed to lose weight, so you think you might have better chances in life, or at least, raise your life expectancy by maybe 5, 10, 15, or even 20 years, let me tell you, love, you're gonna have to do a lot more than 10 minutes. Like, you know how long I sometimes nearly stay in the gym for like nearly 3 hours or very nearly till closing time, just because there's so many things I want to do and so many things I want to like just test for myself and like just for different parts of my body, from using a treadmill, using a stride machine, or using one of those extremely stressful like step machines. They are fantastic for breaking you out into a sweat in 5 minutes, literally. And you burn so many calories because they're so dependent on cardio activity. You'll be losing it in like you'll be losing a lot of weight in days. I mean, on average, I can lose like something of roughly about like nearly an entire pound a day. If for what I've done, maybe I could lose as many as 2 pounds a day through how much I stay on my feet and, you know, walk about and, you know, go to the gym and stuff like that. There are so many ways you could do it, but you cannot do it if you're literally just limiting yourself to 10 minutes a day. Yes, I know, Debbie is 21 stone. You know what? We're going to have to take things by degree. However, that you've got to be extremely realistic about these things. And the reality is you've got to do more, but you can't rush into these sorts of things. And also, why exactly should not wearing like shoes or socks for this?
Calories already.
But calorie conscious Debbie baffled as to why she's still 10 stone
overweight. What the fuck was that?
I get on the plans. I just needed to stop drinking things like Pepsi and eating crisps and stuff like that. You can't turn around and say to somebody, "Oh, because you're obese, it's your fault." It wasn't my fault the weight gain came on.
Debbie has a long list of medical ailments, many of which she believes have contributed to her...
You know, some people might argue, why doesn't Debbie disclose exactly why she is, you know, her size? But I wonder if this is where the show starts drawing in its sense of consciousness or something like that, because it's bad enough. You have to listen to somebody's excuses anyway. It's, again, another very different thing is that they don't actually admit that things are their fault, because I don't think we've even heard, or maybe she has said it and the show won't show us, that she is acknowledging that some things are her own fault. Again, this could be the case, maybe not. And as I've said to many people before, you can't reason with people who are completely unreasonable. But again, maybe she has and the show just doesn't expect us to show it. Who knows? It's, again, you have to really consider exactly what the show shows you, the viewer, that is going to sway your decision.
Excessive weight gain.
I have OCD. I have Othello syndrome. I have fibromyalgia. I have arthritis. I have facial palsy. And I have scoliosis. It makes it even more difficult to get any exercise to be able to lose the weight. I'm burning off my scrambled egg and toast. I can switch off there. I do feel a bit out of breath, actually. I'm going to get a glass of Evian.
In London, 31 Stone Barry can't afford his own treadmill. He receives £73 job seeker's allowance a week, but it's something he wants to change.
I'm so desperate to get back to work. The sooner I get back working, the better.
Lately, Barry's weight has spiralled out of control.
I've always been a big, large person, but I put on about 5-6 stone, and that was due to being depressed of losing my job.
Although his dream job might be a bit hard to net.
My dream job, it would be working with fish. I love fish. Maybe even working in an aquatic centre, owning my own aquatic shop one day. But if you're talking about absolute dream job, working with sharks. Fish have always been a big part of my life, not just keeping them, but fishing as well.
When Barry's not down the job centre, he can be found in his local aquarium.
Fish keeping's a major hobby of mine. I find them very relaxing, very calming. I like to sit and watch them. I could probably sit here all day and tell you a whole list of the things that I love about
and
fish.
Actually, you know what? I like that. And because it's usually way it, the show actually does go a little bit out of its way to show that these people are not, they actually, they are real people and they have like aspirations and they have like emotions. And but when the show does not slag them off, when, you know, they talk about how much we have to pay for them and stuff like that. But then again, when you get to the point where just Debbie from before listing her ailments, and they would be, it still, it makes the show kind of look a little bit even more scummy, the fact that it was they talked oh so badly that we spend on them. That makes that entire scene look 10 times worse if somebody is really going through, really has all those problems. But again, probably people would have to, again, have words with me about that, because, again, it's not the sort of thing that affects people's attitudes towards life and even towards their significant others. You know, there's a lot, all sorts.
Hopefully one day when I can get myself another bigger tank, so I've got my eyes on some big tanks, want to start working and get some cash rolling in, I'm going to get a nice big 6 foot, hopefully.
But fish are an expensive hobby, which Barry just can't afford right now.
I've got 2 empty tanks, so obviously I'm not keeping fish at the moment. I sold some fish, obviously make a little bit of money because I needed it.
So Barry has taken up a cheaper hobby, drawing fish.
I used to do art at school and I was pretty good at it. People have asked me to design tattoos, or design my own tattoo.
Wow.
You might recognise that one. That one's the tattoo on my arm. Japanese goldfish. Queer carp, as you can see, different queer carps.
Today, though, Barry is off fishing for jobs instead.
I'm just heading down to the internet cafe, just printing off CVs and covering letters and stuff like that. I get all sorts of reactions, you'll be surprised. You can see they're all talking amongst themselves and go, oh my God, what, he's just walked through the door. And I've been out of work for now 6 months, so it feels like the pressure's building up a little bit. I do struggle with walking at the moment. My back hurts a little bit, but that's due to my weight. I'm hoping to get back down.
Yeah, you know what, Barry, I'll just say this. You know, this is, again, the side of these programmes you absolutely have to understand. You know what? So what if Barry really is 30-odd stone? You know what? This guy has skills. He has, like, transferable skills. He has he has aspirations. There's things he wants to do, and you know what? It's these sorts of people that you should actually, you know, we should actually be nurturing these sort of things. We need to, you know, even if they could just get this guy, like, I don't know, some work experience to work down a tattoo shop or something like that. Isn't that a better start? And it's, again, part of it comes down to, from what I've seen with my own eyes, is that the job centre, it should be about getting people into work, not keeping them on benefits. So why? And again, from my own experience, they would sometimes even like try and assess me like tasks or just little activities like, can you improve your CV by reviewing it one day and then reviewing it the next day and then reviewing it again and do everything you need to change it and stuff like that. And again, in the case of Barry, you have. And this, I mean this in the fairest and nicest way possible, they're going to have to address the cold, hard facts of what happens if you don't lose this weight. People might say, you know, cruel to be kind, but you know what? I think it's an absolute disgrace when people who absolutely have skills and absolutely can get into work and they're sidelined because of problems like this. Problems that, you know what I mean?
So a really healthy, respectable weight. When I come on a bus, especially like if I know it's going to get packed or something like that, I'll kind of squash myself in. I mainly sit on the front seats or the back seats, so it gives a bit more room. Everyone will come up, they'll take a look around the top deck, and then I'll walk straight back down, even though the seat's sitting right in front of them. You know, a smaller person can quite easily sit next to me. It's quite demoralising. Just check, see if there's any jobs. You never know. Always got to keep my phone close to me. You never know when you're going to get that phone call. Hence my little notebook I bought.
Barry is polishing his CV in a bid to get off the dole. He claims he's applied for over 100 jobs in the last 6 months.
Hello, mate. That's the CV. 9 years retail, 18 years work experience.
Barry doesn't lack experience, but he worries that his 31 stone frame is the real reason he's been out of work so long.
It comes down to discrimination of your size, you know. Being a big, big guy, while you're getting the store manager to do the interview with you, you can tell the other ones are just looking, thinking, oh my God, you know, really? Are you actually really going to be working here with us? I'm not going to let it dampen my spirits. I'm trying to think how I can word it. I don't know if there's other larger people trying to find jobs like I am.
There are plenty of other people out there like Barry. The UK is bulging with giant job seekers. In fact, 2,000 of us are now too fat to work.
That's a phrase I seriously say again. No, you can't say stuff like that. That's just not. It's not even the fact that it's a nasty thing to. It's not even the fact that it's a horrible thing to say. It's the fact it's fundamentally wrong to say stuff like that. I'm sorry. I'm almost tempted literally to stop the entire thing right here because, again. But
21 stone Debbie Wood is out of work and out of patience with her husband and full-time carer, Stephen.
Stop me, bed, please. This is hurting my back.
Right, how do you reset this then?
Just the way you did it with yours. Holy chuffy Nora.
Her adjustable massage bed, bought with her benefits money, is broken and Stephen is tasked with fixing it.
They've all got to come out, haven't they?
This is killing me to stand about. I need to go sit down.
Debbie relies on her husband to look after her, but today his attempts to make her more comfortable have disrupted her daily routine.
I should ideally be on my afternoon snack now, let alone anything else, and I've only had cheese sandwich for my lunch. I should have had breakfast, mid-morning meal, lunch, mid-afternoon, and I should be waiting for my tea right now, not to mention the one...
And Debbie is wondering, you know, it's... What did she say before about, you know, her? It's not being her fault that she's overweight, or it was... And again, you might look at me and probably say that, again, are my attempts to try and defend Debbie are so, like, more in vain, or maybe because I'm trying to, like, stick to my principles about... representation and what you and about certain guidelines that because again the futility of saying stuff like the futility of trying to remain like not morally superior not that it's morally just you know, having a clear conscience and knowing exactly what you think is the right and wrong thing to do. And in situations like these, I always do sort of think to myself, not so much what would Jesus do, but what would Jesus think about what he was going to do? Because it doesn't strike... Even Jesus probably wouldn't even think that if I say what I think I'm going to say... Is it going to make any difference? I mean, I don't know. I don't get it. I don't. What am I supposed to think at this, ladies and gentlemen? Am I supposed to think, because of the list of ailments and problems, that's actually an excuse to literally defend somebody who keeps moaning about having nearly 6 meals a day, or how much aggro and stick that she's giving to her husband? Or the fact that she could spend more of her time actually, you know, going on a treadmill or doing what she can to actually just even shift maybe, I don't know, 3 or so ounces or something like that. Part of the problem I face with, again, this show is that even if you are willing to defend these people to the ends of the earth, the show is going to try your patience anyway. And I think the show knows this and will rely on this. Because it's the only way to make sure you don't feel anything for the people involved except hatred and disgust.
Supper.
This may work.
Going down.
I've partially mended something.
A little bit further up would have been nicer.
Les, who hasn't worked in 9 years, once had an active social life, but these days he rarely gets out.
It's just so hard to go places because of my size.
Since Les can't physically walk to the pub anymore, he's built one in his back garden instead.
Welcome to the bar. I used to go to the pub, but I don't no more. Unless I can use a disabled toilet, I find it uncomfortable with problems with my size and everything. I watch the rugby, have a couple of cans with my mates.
But even playing a game of darts is hard work when you're nearly 3 times the weight of an average British man.
If I stand there for too long, my back goes like a board. I sweat profusely.
Can the show present any evidence about what the average size of a man should be? Because 10 stone seems a little bit... That's a little bit on the thin side of average. Again, the show just throws out these statistics as though we're supposed to, and they don't cite them either. So, in fact, I'll tell you what, because the show won't do it, I will do it myself. Excuse me one second. Right, okay. Okay, so average male weight 85.4 kilos, 188 pounds. Let's hang on. So it's 13.4286. So the show can't even get that right. Maybe again, maybe by 2023 standards. And what year did this come out again? Will it let us know? No, it won't. I wondered. Okay, so we're going back online in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
And lots and lots of pain. We can't do this no more. That's it, I can't go no more. I do feel I'm missing out on life. There's things my friends do that I'd like to do with them, but I can't no more. They say, oh, we're going out for a night, do you want to come? I've got to turn it down straight away, you know, because I know I just couldn't do it physically.
Les has faced other obstacles since he's piled on the pounds. As well as being too fat to work, Les is now too fat to fly.
There was a gang of us went to Ireland to watch the rugby, and they said, if there was anyone on your trip who's over 20 stone, you have to book 2 seats. So I bit the bullet, bought the 2 seats. Day arrived, we get to the airport. I was on different sides of the plane, row 17 and row 19. And the annoying part as well, I paid for 2 seats but only got 1 meal.
Make sure he took the plates, you know, I don't like food on cold plates.
In Leicester, it's supper time in the Wood household.
Did you test them with a fork?
Yeah, I did, they seem fairly soft.
Maybe just scoop those middle bits out and then put them in for a few more minutes.
Rearrange them a bit and put them back in.
Yeah.
Alright.
Morbidly obese Debbie is being waited on by husband Stephen, who gets nearly £700 a month in carer's allowance and income support.
I have got this job now as being Debbie's carer. That is, in itself, a job. That is my job.
Get us a Bulmers.
Oh, I can do that, yeah.
That'd be lovely. Have it nice and chilled.
Right, I'm off.
Stephen, who is half his wife's weight and much more mobile, makes regular trips to the shops on her behalf.
I will do this walk about two or three times a day. She does ask for a lot, but then again, a lot does need to be done. Not a job I expected to take on board, but now that I am, I'm going to do the best I can.
Watch on mobile device.
You had last time.
Right.
I don't think people realise just how draining being a carer can actually be.
Well, way to go on portion control with those chips.
Is there nothing else there?
Salad cream, perhaps.
You know, again, I don't disagree with what Stephen says. However, I think it's another thing entirely when people are, again, this unappreciative. It does. Has she ever once said, you know, please or thank you or anything like this? That's the thing, again, you pick up on stuff like this. And again, maybe it's the show, you know, the things they cut out, you know, that might be the case. But that kind of almost makes me a little bit more suspicious of the show as well, in all honesty.
Great. You didn't drain the chips off very well, Lovey.
I do feel like I've done a 9-to-5. Literally. It drains you more mentally than physically.
You sit down and be a good boy. That's not sitting down and being a good boy. Get off.
Debbie's day is starting to wind down, but Stephen's chores are still mounting up.
I'm probably going to have a bit of a nap at the moment because I'm really tired. This has been a long day for me. I'm feeling a bit drained, and then I'll probably go do some gaming and maybe have a sip of cider if I may feel up to it.
Coming up.
Speed did a stream where he's getting wisdom tooth surgery.
Oh, yeah, I know about that, yeah.
He's like moaning at the woman.
I'll get back to that, Patrick. I'll just let me know something, that's all.
No one asked, don't worry.
Well. I literally got up and something just like me knee is just locked. Oh well, it's one of those things that happens. It'll sort itself out by the morning. Just need to give it a bit of a stretch and then I'll be right for tomorrow.
Up, will Leslie's doctor recommend him for weight loss surgery?
Hopefully, I get back into work and then stop being a massive drain on NHS resources.
And the council install a brand new kitchen for Debbie, but she's not happy about it.
Well, crap, that fucking cupboard. Hot staff.
I'll choose to ignore that.
21 Stone Debbie and her husband Steve get £1,500 a month in benefits. They pay £60 a week in rent, and their council tax is reduced because they have a wet room installed by the council for Debbie.
I'm happy with the way they've done the tiles, I'm happy the way that they've done the cupboards. I'm not happy that they damaged my dishwasher and had no insurance to cover it, so I had to buy another one.
She's also just had a brand new kitchen installed by the council, but she doesn't seem happy.
The plastering is absolutely abysmal. You feel how rough that is, and that drawer is so small that the only thing that I keep in there is... I like the cupboards, except these ones are a bit too small for my plates now. So I can't put plates in there, I have to be putting that.
You know, actually, psychologically, that's actually one of the best things you can possibly do when you're dieting. Actually buy smaller plates, because any meal would look large on a small plate. However, I know, again, it's par for the course at this point to say that You don't believe everything you see, but again, what exactly do these people get out of this show? Behave like an absolute pig, and just to get on telly, is that what this is all about? Behave as deplorably as you possibly can, and you might get the chance to go on telly, or we might just do the bare minimum and shift that old washing machine for you, or tumble drive, or whatever it's meant to be.
A cupboard down there where he has to come and take them out for me. Out of 100, I would give it 60. And they didn't finish this bit off here. They're supposed to put tiles on here. They've cracked that fucking cupboard. I thought they had. So cracking that cupboard at the top, look.
That, I think you'll find, is paint. Yeah.
Hot good stuff. Do you know what? I guarantee, I bet they haven't swept out under here, and I bet they've just put those bits of bloody wood underneath it.
Yeah.
I have to get the council to come and pick up that old dishwasher. Like for the rich and famous. Get the council in, take away the dishwasher. That's how much money we have that we live in a council house. And
yeah.
You know, we must be scum because we're on benefits. We don't keep a clean home and we smoke and drink our money away.
Yeah.
The painting, what it needs is sanded down and it's finished.
Debbie, can I just, again, just in case this next tangent might go on for a bit, when people, for a few things, the first is that the only real people that have actually seen, you know, that point and, you know, point fingers and say they must be the worst sort of human beings alive who live on the state and don't work, sometimes I think it's mostly themselves, the people who say it, you know, the ones who are unemployed. I feel like it's a self-defeating, like, prophecy here when people, you know, you think that's what they're thinking, but no, that's not entirely the case. And, you know, not everybody is awful, ladies and gentlemen. That's what some people need to understand, is that not everybody is awful. Secondly, she's... the cold hard facts of this. She doesn't work. She relies on disability allowance. Her husband is her carer. She gets a new kitchen, even though, you know, despite her criticisms, she gets a massage bed. Her husband then fixes it for her. She doesn't really say thank you for any of it. She gets fed. She doesn't go outside. And does she seem... Why on earth has she suddenly got the right to start complaining about what people are going to think about her now? This is, again, I might just... I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll even go through the comments, because this should say everything. Debbie is all what's wrong with society. I have dwarfism and an autoimmune chronic pain condition. I still work. A good point is that many people do have these sorts of things and they still work, absolutely. Although I'm hoping the benefits people watching her would move and okay her, deny her disability benefits. That's another huge point as well. Some people would literally just say, that's it. You know, learn to behave better and maybe you'll get something back. The more I watch, the more I feel sorry for her husband. You can tell he's lost his confidence and she's mentally eating him alive. You're supposed to support each other in a relationship, not tear each other down. True, absolutely, yes. Some gratitude would go a long way in Debbie's life. She's one miserable person. Misery as well could be another contributing factor into all this, is that because this is her life, and maybe it is impossible to see anything better. I figure there will be some Karens that disagree, but sitting on your behind and eating all day and not entitle you to disability, it's self-inflicted, and without effort to correct the situation, you've made your bed and you should lie in it if you don't want to contribute to getting well, then contributing to society. And a lot of these are actually a lot about Debbie. Debbie is abusing the system. Debbie is the perfect example of entitlement. Let's see. I've obviously been watching too much Foodie Beauty and Amber Lynn Reed, because I just watched this and she doesn't look that obese to me. She is able to move around. She doesn't need a caregiver. Debbie has serious mental health issues. She is abusive and controlling. How is Debbie getting £1,500 a month? If Debbie had the energy to bark orders, that Debbie individual and a so-called carer husband typify all that's wrong with the system. I have no sympathy for those who are entitled because they cannot control their extreme weight. And there were some very positive ones about Barry, I must say. And this is, again, what you have to understand is that Debbie might think, possibly, that all people who are on benefits are scroungers and the absolute scum of the earth and they just don't want to work. Or maybe that's just the mentality of people who are in work that look down on people like them. But again, there are people who absolutely have fantastic skills who are unemployed. And I remember a very short story. When I was working in a job centre, ladies and gentlemen, I was part of cleaning staff. There was a girl who came in with her mother from Romania, and she was a classically this I think she was about like either 16 or 17. She was a classically trained violin player, and she came into and her mother came into the job centre once, and because they just wanted to know if they could get something for like maybe a summer job. Or maybe just something a little bit more part-time. And they spoke like the heavens had opened up, and these two very gentle-spirited, very, very reasonable and fair people, they just want to ask for some work, just for something to get them by, or just something to pass the time where her daughter was going to be, you know, maybe sent to one of those music schools down in London, because I knew somebody from school who left at 14 to go to a music school in London. But you know, again, this is the point I'm trying to make. Not everybody is awful, and that's the end of the story. But people like Debbie, again, maybe it's the show. But she acts awful. Maybe she's not awful, but she acts awful. Maybe that's all it comes down to. They say that actually 100 years ago in India, during the days of the British Raj, they say that in India, you are not judged for what you do, but for what you are. And who knows, maybe after 100 years, that mentality might come back in some way, and maybe that will be the way that the state of the law might run. Who knows?
And it needs another two coats of paint.
Yeah.
In South Wales, 35 Stone Les is also on disability benefit. Today, he's organising his medication for the week.
So far this morning, I've got up, had breakfast. Now it's time to refill all my tablets.
My God.
These tramadol painkillers. This is gabapentin because of the diabetes. Omeprazole be to help with the effects of the painkillers. This one, I'm not sure. I think it's because of the wounds I keep getting. Last one to help with my waterworks. That's my citalopram, which is for my mental stability, and I think that's it. I take about 17 tablets a day. If the pain is bad, I can take more of the painkillers.
Les has to take medication for various health
problems. And again, just the sheer volume, and again, not going off the fact that maybe some of these are painkillers, what do you think could be the result then? A lifetime of like addiction, of dependence upon painkillers. It's... I might literally go and watch, you know, What About Bunny? You know, the talking sheepadoodle immediately after this, because I'll be honest, I need something to cheer me up after this. This is, like, downright depressing.
Problems related to his size.
Some people get their tablets ready done in blister packs and have them delivered. I think I might look into that if I got to keep taking this many. I do this job every week.
But even putting pills into their boxes causes pain and discomfort for Les.
You in pain, Les?
Yes, my shoulder today. I've had cortisone injection in it, but this morning it don't seem to be doing anything for me. I just got to sit here and everyone moves around me. Because I'm useless.
Stone Barry is still jobless, but today he's getting help. Confidence coach Annie Ashdown wants to find out why Barry's stuck on the dole.
Whether he has to work twice as hard because of his weight, creating an impact is crucial, but I really believe that what's bigger than weight and what's bigger than height and what's bigger than everything is an energy that says I'm confident. And if somebody isn't feeling good they need to look at why they're carrying that weight and changing that as well. If the employer feels that person feels good about themselves and they're going to deliver, I don't see why the weight would be an issue.
Barry has worked in the past, but since piling on the pounds, he's struggled to find a job.
A question about, you know, the weight issue. Well, there's quite a number of things. Self-confidence, physical exhaustion. Then there's also about the discomfort when it comes to sitting, because again, the amount of weight, perhaps in front, for example, can cause, you know, chronic problems for your back. There's also just the dependence, and because again, it's actually quite a bit of a large leap when you're out of work and you get back into work. You have to sort of adjust yourself mentally and physically to get into a routine where it revolves around like a state of urgency and stuff like that. So there's a lot of other things to consider as well, and it did take a little bit of adjusting, like after maybe like two or so days by the time I got myself back into work. But the important point, ladies and gentlemen, is this. Again, that's the thing. Again, I often, like, when it came to me and when I started to lose weight, I always looked at it from the perspective of, if I can do it, then the result would be is that I never would have thought it would have been as easy as this. And sometimes in life, you've just got to get on with it. And then that sort of thing opens the floodgates. And to people like Barry, that could absolutely be the case. Because if, for example, he even if he went down from 31 stone to 21 stone, then if he could do that, then he could get himself maybe down to 20 stone or 19 or 18 or 17 or 16 or 15. If you could do something as huge as like half your weight just in like a year or 2 years, you could turn your life around by doing stuff like that. So, and think about the sort of things you'll be able to do, and you won't feel like exhausted or out of breath, or the stress it will take off your internal organs as well, like your heart or your liver or your kidneys and stuff like that. It goes so much further, and the results go so much further than you might think. And again, I'm not an expert on this sort of thing. I'm just going off from what I know because of what I've experienced. And again, maybe my ways are not always the right ways, and they might not work out for everyone, but it has to be said, I just got on with it, and here we are.
Redundant?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I've been made redundant quite a few times in my career.
What I want to ask is, do you believe in yourself?
Inside, I actually feel quite not very confident at all.
I have a strong suspicion that your redundancies have knocked your confidence.
The last one certainly knocked my confidence. Actually, I gained 6 stone in weight.
So would you say you're an emotional eater?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
And would you like to change that?
Yeah, you know, I'm open to so many ideas in order to sort that out.
You know, regardless of how you feel about emotionally eating and carrying some excess weight, if you will feel better and stronger and more robust if you look at the emotional eating side of things. Because something's blocking you getting a job. And would you be happy to show me what you do when you go to an interview? No clenching the fists.
I find it quite difficult because of my size.
Yes.
It's natural for me to want to go like that. That's just a natural reaction.
This is where I'm seeing you not being confident with your size, if you don't mind me saying.
No, you're right. You're completely right.
And I say
right.
This
I'm
with
not.
Love. I've been there. So yeah. Let me just do something with you, if I may. So, back, straight. Now, how does that feel?
Like a soldier.
Okay, so I want you to close your eyes for a moment. Just visualise in front of you a massive screen with the outcome of you getting your job.
Emotional eater Barry dreams of working with fish, but feels his size holds him back.
Just...
You know, again, not to knock this narrator again, but couldn't we just have some footage of Barry saying any of this? It would actually do him the world of good if he actually just openly admitted in camera in front of someone. And again, ladies and gentlemen, again, when I was on Universal Credit and I then started opening up on my own to what I was interested in and what I showed about what I was doing and stuff like that, that made them think that actually there's so much. There's the world of potential out there. I just don't think... I know, again, we have to address the issues, but, you know, you give the man a break a little bit, you know what I'm saying? You know, you can tell, obviously, he's not confident, so you got to raise his confidence. You know, good cop, bad cop. Some people can only play bad cop to certain people. I've seen too many accounts of all this, and it's awful. It's just awful.
Visualize it really clearly, really clearly. You can open your eyes now.
Oh.
It's all too much for Barry.
Oh.
Again, we can tell, we know this.
What came up for you during that?
Just all the sort of dream jobs I wanted to do and where I could have been 15 years ago if I'd have done it then. And I had the confidence to go and do them.
What age are you, Barry?
35.
Oh my God, you can so do it.
And you see all your friends, they got family, kids, they got really good jobs, and you kind of feel on the shelf a little bit.
You can have that too. Do you want a hug?
Yeah, please, yeah.
Can I just, again, I'm going to have to like pause this again because I really, really need to say this because if I don't say this, I'm going to regret it for the rest of my life as well. It's not just about people who are overweight, who have extreme issues with self-confidence. This could be brought upon by a multitude of factors. Environmental, problems at home, problems at school, bullying, a lack of nurturing, systematic bullying, emotional or mental. The sight of the world seems so unfair that it works itself as a system in some people's minds that the world is unfair to those who want to be fair. I'll be honest, 10 years ago, ladies and gentlemen, realistically, the problem is it goes back nearly 15 years for people like me, where I thought like the world was very unfair and it did horrible things to people who did no harm whatsoever to others. 10 years ago, I was caught in this web where whether I liked it or not, I was in it. And the things that were in my control, I took full advantage of. The things that weren't in my control still haunt me to this day, because it's like you get gaslighted into thinking that actually it was all your fault, that you don't stand up for yourself. The world, there's something about the way the world is, and maybe this is just the way I look at it, but there's something about the way that people expect you to know things without ever being taught or without ever being expressed a sentiment of it doesn't have to be like this, or you know what, the reason why you don't cause trouble or stand up for yourself is maybe because some people are not like that. Some people are too considerate for other people's emotions, that they want to step, they don't want to cause trouble, and they don't want to feel, because it brings up on a feeling of selfishness in some people. And I've been down that road many, many times. And where do you think it got me, ladies and gentlemen? It got me nowhere. And then all sorts of things start circling around your mind like sharks about why on earth do I have to be reasonable in a world full of unreasonable people? You know what? I do what I think is the right thing to do, not just for myself, but for my family, for my parents, for my friends, my work colleagues. I just do what I know I have to do. And some people literally hate that. And they express no, and then they express the sentiment to let themselves know this. And while all this is going on, the people who lose out in these sorts of instances are those who just... Is it really, out of the realm of possibility to say that maybe the reason why I developed like a food problem when I was 14 is because when I held up like an all-day breakfast sandwich in my hands at 14 and I could picture it still, you know, where I was in this very room and all the rest of it, and it's almost like almost like going back through some sort of like traumatic experience. As I held up that sandwich, it had like bacon, tomato, sausage, like semblance of an egg and stuff like that. It had all that in there, and it couldn't talk back to me. It couldn't insult me. It couldn't ridicule me. It couldn't take control. It couldn't take advantage of me. It was something that I had control, and it was something that designed from its very birth to be consumed. And just like that, the rest was history. But maybe again, and you take joy, and I took joy in the fact, I didn't take joy in the fact that, you know what, I was eating food that I thought was delicious. I took joy in the fact that it was something I had control over. And again, maybe it's not for all cases, but part of me now begins to sort of like suspect, maybe, just maybe, some people's issues with food, obesity, it might be just out of a sense of the fact that it's the only real joy they have left. And maybe, again, it would almost even explain why Debbie is so, you know, demanding and unreasonable to her husband, because food doesn't excite her or joy her any much. And maybe that's why her standards are so unreasonably high, because she wants the most out of everything without having to rely on the fact that maybe it's not going to be as good as it might be, because her standards are what they are, and some things are what they are. And that's why maybe, again, Debbie will find its life is going to get a lot harder on it, because her outlook is based on false beliefs that everything circles around her. But then again, with Barry, again, maybe this is the first love or affection, or maybe just the first bit of, like, you know, contact, physical contact he might have had with somebody for such a long time, because of all sorts of reasons. And again, if there's one thing I want to absolutely get out of this, is that Barry is doing much better in life. That's the one thing I hope for out of all this. I really, really do.
Oh, what are you like? You can do this.
It's gave me confidence now to think you're worth more than where you are now.
Looking at his weight would be a really good move as well, because he's going to feel better in himself. And he's going to feel more empowered if he takes control of his food.
His size might still be an issue, but Barry's got a new spring in his step after today's session. 35 stone Les Price is getting help too. Today he's off to hospital to find out if he's eligible for a free gastric band on the NHS.
When I was about 8 years old, my mother and father sent me down to the dietitians. The dietitian said that it's just puppy fat, and I'm now a great big puppy. If I was given the intervention years ago, I would be earning money, not taking money from the system. But, you know, again, I worked all my life, so why can't I have a little bit back? If healthy food was cheaper...
Just exactly what I said. Listen to this.
It would be a lot easier. You get farm food offers through the doors, and they got pizzas on their offer. Oh, two pizzas for £1. As where you go to buy something like apples, you get four for £1. Well, four apples don't make a meal. As where a pizza can.
Les. Exactly. You know, Les, this is what I've been saying for 2 whole years, and Les fucking nailed it out of the park. You know what? I hope they give this man 2 gastro bands. I hope they give him all the help they can. This guy fucking gets it, and it's a fucking shame what happens to people like this when just through some stupid accident, things end up like this.
Might blame his weight on cheap junk food, but excuses won't help him today. He's here to find out if he's lost enough weight to qualify for gastric surgery, which includes...
Well, I don't even think the idea of, you know, what he's saying is exactly an excuse, because there is a lot to be said about it. Because, and I'll say this again, and I get until the cows come home. Would it not be better if, you know, people resorted to buying, you know, wholesome food and that instead of wasting it on 2-for-1 pizzas? Yes, of course it would. But the point is that no ordinary human being, whether they are in work or out of it, is ever going to do such a thing as that. Because, again, when you're unemployed, meaning when you're broke, starved, harassed, bored and miserable, you don't want to eat dull, wholesome foods. You want something a little bit tasty. Not because they are, you know, any way healthier, but because they are nicer, as the theory goes.
Including aftercare will cost the taxpayer approximately £10,000.
From being
fuck it, you know what? Again, if it means getting this man into work, and if his determination and is anything to go by, go right ahead. I absolutely think he should. Because again, I know people who are even in work who get paid for gastric bands, because they seriously admit that their health, their weight is a problem, and I don't have to pass any judgment on that whatsoever, because at the end of the day, it's their decision. It's not exactly within my power to start saying that, you know what, Les should stay exactly as he is, because obviously it's not working.
Very active to being like this. It's hard work. Yeah, it's a struggle to walk. My arthritis is playing up with my knee as well. Cold weather don't help.
But getting from the car to the hospital is a long distance when you weigh 35 stone.
Thanks again for reminding us. For God's sake. Must think we got like the memories of like goldfish.
I've been coming to see Dr. Booby 20 years. It's been really hard this time. My physical needs are a lot different. I got a job to walk from the car park. I'm not actually mobile properly. I'm sweating like a pig now. Is there anybody there?
Hello.
Hello. Little Les.
First, it's crunch time. Has Les lost enough weight?
A step on then. So you've lost £4.25 since we last saw you.
Oh, that's a lot, isn't it?
Les should have lost £8 since his last weigh-in. He's lost just over half of what the hospital have advised.
I was hoping for more now, but it's off, that's the thing about it.
Les, good morning, sir.
Morning, Professor.
How are you, sir?
Oh, bearing up.
In a year, you've lost 2 stones.
It's not bad.
You could do better. So what did you have for breakfast today?
McDonald's.
Did you have to?
No, it was a case of on the rush.
Can you just stand for me?
As well as being weighed, Dr. Habobi measures Les before deciding if he'll qualify for surgery.
Well, it's 3 centimetres.
Oh, 6 centimetres.
Okay. So we've lost weight. Personally, I think we should refer you again.
Yeah.
It's the good news Les has been hoping for.
I know the operation isn't the answer to everything, but with my mobility and how I'm getting worse, Dr. Abobi thinks it's one of the best things they could do for me at the moment. If I get that, my life could turn around and hopefully I get back into work and then stop being a massive drain on NHS resources.
Obesity and problem related to obesity is costing billions, the NHS. Surgery isn't expensive, but on the long term, surgery actually would probably save money.
Are you worried about Les?
Yes, I am.
There's a still over.
It did take him a little bit of a while for him to answer, but then again, referring to people is, again, they're doctors, they're not people's best friends, and you know what, just again, because of, you know, things about how like the things like the NHS work is that, you know what? A meal is a meal to Les, just as Les is simply a case for the doctor. And he will simply be a case for the surgeon, for example. That's just how it is, for better or worse.
For another 20 stone to shift. You know, people and an employer are not going to look at me and say, oh yeah, come and have a job, because I've been thought of as a liability when I was 20 stone. So, you know, being 15 stone heavier than that isn't going to look good as a prospect.
Meanwhile,
being unemployed gives Debbie and her husband and carer Steve plenty of time to indulge in their favourite hobby, gaming.
In terms of how many hours a day we spend playing games or whatever, I think it's probably more than half the day. She's on the Xbox 360, I'm on the Xbox One. She plays Terraria and Call of Duty. I play Minecraft and Forza. While I'm doing that, she's wanting drinks getting and food making.
You want toast now, don't you?
Yes, I do. You must be some kind of mind reader.
The good thing about this relationship is, before I met Debbie, I couldn't even cook pasta. And now I know how to do things like salmon and steak and stuff like that. I am just totally bossing that now.
These have turned out all right, actually. I never normally know quite what I'm doing with scrambled eggs.
Don't leave it in here in front of the fan. It's going to get cold again, isn't it?
Yeah.
Steve spent 4 years at university and has worked in the past, but these days he's paid to look after his wife instead.
Being Debbie's carer, that's both physically and mentally tiring.
Today, Debbie, not content with the two game consoles she...
I do think that's kind of funny, actually, how he said that, because I think he just almost admitted that, yes, this is, like, a drain and... Dear. I mean, again, Steve is just... He's like Barry, he's like the real hero of this.
Already has is using her benefits money to shop for another console online.
Why?
There's some ones that are a bit pricey. I'm trying to find ones that are about a couple of $100. See, that one there, I would definitely go for. I mean, you're talking mint condition for £140, which is a good deal. Ooh, this one looks good. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to...
What you're going to do is eat your scrambled egg on toast. And what I'm going to do is take the cut away.
As long as I can do it in peace. Hint, hint.
Yeah.
Oh, can you get me the black pepper first, babes?
Yeah.
Thanks.
That might be the only time that she's ever said thanks in this entire programme. And that the programme doesn't even bother to show it on screen, the words leaving her mouth. So, again, who knows...
Oh, and can you get me a glass of orange juice?
Right.
Coming up, jobless Debbie puts Stephen's loyalty to the test with a lie detector.
What?
Oh, lie your pants and fire.
And will Les fall off the wagon in his bid for weight loss surgery?
My health is playing me up. I've got gout in my right foot now.
Ugh. So, are you ready then?
Yeah, I'll just get my shoes on.
Today, unemployed and overweight Debbie Wood is leaving her council house for the first time in 8 months.
The only worry I have is, will she see somebody that she thinks is a threat to her, or will she see someone that she thinks I'm going to be attracted to that will cause a big argument later on, perhaps? But we're not going to get anywhere sat in here at the end of the day all the time, so it's not going to be easy, but it's for the best.
I'll be saying it your heart out, Kim Kardashian. Oh, it's lovely out here.
It's bright,
isn't it? I think I got my sunglasses on. My anxiety because of my weight, I feel that people are going to be looking at me, pointing at me. I've had it happen, and laughing at me. So that really makes me feel self-conscious. It's a nice little walk.
It's not bad.
I'm actually enjoying it because it's like you've got trees and stuff.
She goes outside the door, she'll think, oh, people are going to be horrible to me and all that, which I have seen happen, actually. I've been there when that's happened. Now, a group of people called out something to him in some foreign language that I didn't know what they were saying. They might have been complimentary, it might not have been, but you don't know. That's the disconcerting thing about that.
Well, if you don't know, then okay, whatever.
So, where's the general store then?
It's just where that junction is.
All right, that little shop thing, yes, Shepherd's Store.
It's that close.
Wow. I'm really enjoying this. Once I get out, I'm fine. It's just the getting out.
I mean, look at it, I can't even see a cloud.
I know, it's gorgeous, isn't it?
Yeah.
So far, so good. Stephen has coaxed his wife to the local shop for the first time since they moved there 8 months ago.
This is a good little shop, actually. Wish I'd known it was closer.
I know there's something else.
That's where you can get my deep heat rug at some point as well.
Yeah.
Now that I know what they've got, I'll be writing you a list.
But it's not long before Debbie spots some competition.
Since when did you like Mel B?
You know, when the Spice Girls were big when I was at school, I couldn't name three Spice Girls songs.
Thanks, bye.
Told you it was all right around here, didn't I?
Yeah, it's not too bad, actually. I quite like it. And what I do in my own personal relationship and in my own business and in my own time is my own thing.
Back home, Stephen's attempts to get his wife out of the house have backfired, bringing out Debbie's jealous side.
Well, this is a lie detector app that I've installed on my phone, basically to see if he's telling the truth to me about things, because obviously I want the truth and people do lie.
One of Debbie's many medical ailments is Othello syndrome, meaning she gets jealous and paranoid of Stephen cheating on her.
We went out to the shop and there were like two or three females around.
Just for your information, Debbie, I studied Othello when I was about 15. Can I just interject? Othello was a Shakespearean tragedy. This is not a tragedy. This is downright sinister.
So I'm going to ask you if you noticed them.
Can't say as I did, no.
I'm impressed. You're telling the truth.
And Debbie's disorder is also one of the reasons carer Stephen feels he could never hold down a job in the outside world.
Me getting a job in the future is something I've thought about, but with her mental condition, me getting a job, would she be wondering what I'm up to 24/7?
We were talking about Mel B in the shop. I want to know is, did you find her picture attractive?
No.
So you did find Mel B attractive then? Right.
Unconvinced he's telling the truth about his feelings for Mel B, Debbie makes Stephen retake the test.
Light your pants into fire. Look at that middle line. Well then, conclusive evidence says that you find Mel B attractive. Actually, the way he's acting is annoying me more than anything else. That's what upsets me.
What Debbie doesn't realise is that my brain is actually really boring and nothing really goes on in there, but she tries to make out that something is going on in there. Maybe it's because I've been to uni and she thinks I've got all these amazing thoughts in my head, but actually it's just probably a carton of milk falling over.
The reason I use that one is because it actually does do the polygraph, and that is at least 60% accurate, and that's why I do it three times, just to see if it's the app that's at fault, or him.
Oh, I know what the truth is, that's all that matters.
I have this inbuilt sixth sense that tells me when people are lying to me and I'm not stupid.
Unemployed and overweight Barry has been looking for work for 6 months. Today, he's getting spruced up for an interview with a storage company. It could be the big break that Big Barry has been waiting for. And after a recent confidence coaching session, Barry's feeling more positive about his size.
I've never had any issues with any of my jobs previously about weight. I've never had to rely on anyone to take over from a job because of my size.
Barry is still nervous that his size could put his potential employers off.
When I've gone for previous job interviews, I felt really sort of self-conscious about my weight and noticed a few things that's going on in interviews, looks and funny stares and smiles and giggles, that type of thing. I'm hoping it won't be an issue, and I think if I carry myself really well, good posture, good question answering, and show my personality and show how much I want the job, then hopefully that'll shine through.
After an interview and assessment, Barry is told he's not got the job due to failing the maths test.
I'm choked. I really wanted a job like this.
Hopefully, by losing weight, get myself back into work and fully fit. Not every fat person is someone who's gonna sit down and do no work all day.
For Barry, the job hunt continues. Not going to an interview anytime soon is 35 stone Les.
Oh, come on.
He was recently put forward for a gastric band to help him finally get back into shape and back into work. But his health has deteriorated dramatically, leaving him completely sofa-bound.
I've got gout in my right foot now.
Oh, my God.
His gout is caused by his poor diet and has left him unable to stand.
You can see the difference in the ankle, the top of the foot, as where this one is all fleshy. This one's all swollen. It's very uncomfortable.
He's had gout for 13 days, leaving him almost completely reliant on his family.
Oh, being like this at the moment is very disheartening. Every little thing you've got to ask somebody for help, it's demoralising.
Hello.
Could you get me some cherries or some raspberries, please? Cherries, preferably.
Yeah.
Because they're supposed to be good for helping with gout.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Ta. Hopefully they'll come back with some goodies. And have a nice cup of tea then. And dinner.
It's not good news for Les, who's supposed to be getting more active to help him lose weight before surgery.
My mobility is near enough zero at the moment. I've had to be helped from the bedroom into here this morning by my partner and my daughter. And I'm not the easiest thing to try and help because I'm rather large.
On days like this, Les relies on his partner Christine to help him out. But when she's busy, he's got a novel way of getting to those hard-to-reach places.
It's a good job I've got my grabber to grab a scratch with, because otherwise I can't get to it, or I've got to try and use something else to scratch with, and it's not easy. Home bargain special. And it's very handy indeed. Whatever I want. Days like this, without anyone to help me, I'd be knackered. I'd be stuck in the bed, and I'd only have, well, I'd have nothing. I'd be useless.
Okay, that took... We've been here for, like... How long have we been here? Like, nearly 2 hours? Dear me. If there's any, like, final thoughts I really want to have about all this, and... There's an entire rabbit hole I'll probably be... I've almost gone down now about all this. Because one thing I really... Really just want to, like, just say at this point right now is that there's no doubt there's people out there who take it even worse than people who take advantage of the system, but it's almost entirely, you can always see that they take advantage of other people. That's how it starts, and that's where it keeps going. And the only thing I could really like count myself lucky as far as this side as far as all this are going and all that is, well, that one day, you know what, I will lose, like, I, By at one point, probably maybe by the end of this year, I actually want to weigh roughly 9 stone. I actually almost want to, like, that's like nearly losing 6 more stone before this year is over, which is less than 8 months away. Meanwhile, there's just this I want to say. Maybe I should have really, like, looked for jobs for, like, the civil service or do this sort of thing, because as time goes on, and I hope to God more than anything, like, attitudes about this change, because, again, what is the objective aim for appearing on shows like this? What do people get out of it? And I... Yeah, anyway. That's just about all I've got to say for that, and again, the way shows like these ends by just saying exactly what happened just almost immediately after they stopped filming, you do, of course, get the idea, ladies and gentlemen, is that, again, these sort of shows just end sometimes with no happy ending, or there's no accountability, or there's just... sometimes it's just another cruel day in another cruel world. Anyway, there we go. I will see all of you guys again in the next video. Jesus Christ, 2 whole hours. I could have been at the gym and, like, literally broke a leg or something like that. My God.